A Gulf Coast gem is Mobile, Alabama, vital to maritime industries, supporting commerce and naval history. It's home to the USS Alabama, and today the tide of NASCAR's K&M Pro Series East rolls in for the first time. Welcome back to Mobile, Alabama for the Mobile 150 presented by the Mobile Sports Authority. A gorgeous afternoon. Racing pushed back a full 24 hours so the K&M Pro Series East can have a beautiful day to go racing instead of all the rain, Frank. We never would have gotten things started on Friday and Saturday.
No, and they've got an extremely fast half mile that they're going to race on, very similar to New Smyrna. So the guys were here a week ago testing. A lot of them that were in the field today were here testing. So they're ready for the demands of this racetrack.
Drivers with experience on this track, drivers with recent testing, they'll look to do well this afternoon. Derek?
You know, Dave, Frank, one of our Who to Watch drivers is going to be starting from the pole. That is the rookie Spencer Davis. He finished second at New Smyrna Speedway the last time out, but left that track with a bent race car. They put a new clip on it, they came back, and now they're sitting on the pole today. Like we said earlier in the top of the show, he's got four top fives in five starts in the NASCAR K&N Pro Series. He comes to us from the NASCAR Whelen Southern Modified Tour. He's also done a lot of time in full-fendered cars like late models and super late models, and he'll be one of the guys to watch this afternoon.
And that team, Frank, is pretty strong.
Yeah, and it's a fairly new team. You know, I mean, Lauren Rainier has come on board this year, but Mike Kilman had that program running last year. So it's new people coming on board and teaming up with Mike Kilman. Lauren Rainier, obviously the son of the great late Harry Rainier, who Cale Yarborough, everybody remembers winning all those races back in the day. He's come on board with Mike Kilman, but they've brought some veterans over. Marty Lindley's the crew chief on Kyle Benjamin's car. Mark McFarland is on board as the competition director. And then Doug Howe is the crew chief for Spencer Davis. Those three guys, two of those three, were at H. Scott Motorsports last year. So a strong program.
Here's how they'll line up. You see Spencer Davis in the 41 there. He's on the pole.
Now I'm looking at Harrison Burton in row two and his three other teammates, Tyler Dipple, Hunter Bayes, and Justin Haley from H. Scott Motorsports.
See the main driver, Austin Terrio, on the inside of row six. Jesse Little in the 29 car starts outside of row number seven.
Yeah, and don't forget the two Bassetts, Ronnie Bassett Jr. and Dylan Bassett. Both were extremely fast at New Smyrna.
The 0-2 of Sarah Cornett-Ching inside row 12 picked up a sponsor announced this week. Dickies will be with her for the entire season, and that's great news. So after a soggy start to the weekend, we are ready to go racing on a gorgeous afternoon. Dominique and Davis leading them to the green. K&N cars race in Alabama for the first time. Davis with a great jump, but Dominique Van Wieringen back on the outside.
Wow, that's an impressive move. Look at the run she gets down the back straightaway there.
Makes it stick in turn three. She's got the advantage. Dominique Van Wieringen is going to lead lap one.
She's not worried about those tires right now at all. She just wants to lead.
She puts the 30 car out front. Spencer Davis now back to second. Trey Hutchins in the black and yellow 14 runs third.
You know, these racetracks, they've got this banking right here. So much fun to race on because look at them right here. Early on, we're already seeing double file throughout the field.
Dipple and Burton battle for that fourth spot. And it looks like Dipple's going to get it right now as Burton's other teammate, Justin Haley, in the five car, he'll move through on the inside.
It makes Dominique move on the outside that much more impressive. Yeah. The fact that she could clear the leader when you see right there that the inside obviously seems to be the preferred line early on.
Well, and you said, Frank, she doesn't care about tires right now. But remember, we've got a 150-lap race. There will be a competition caution at or about the halfway mark. They do get to change four tires, but you got to conserve them at, you know, up to that point.
Well, you know, you can go both ways with that. You could say that you want to just go as hard as you can in this first segment, because if you want to figure out if you go that hard, does lap 50 the tires start to fall off, or are you able to carry that speed all the way through the run? This first segment, really, if you will, is the time to find it out. We got a caution.
Oh no, David Calabrese, trouble on the 43. And that car looks as if it's gone up in smoke. First time for him.
Yeah, that looks terminal right there, Dave. It doesn't sound like it's running right there. He's coasting it in. You see a lot of smoke out from underneath the engine compartment.
Yep, first time at Mobile. Second start ever in the series for David. And his day is way, way too short.
That's tough break for him. You know, he's come down all the way from New Jersey. He's where he's from. And, you know, to come down here, he's been struggling all weekend. I talked to him a little bit. The car wasn't as fast as they wanted to be in practice, but he certainly would like to be able to go further in the race.
Under caution for the first time here in Mobile, Dominique Van Wieringen leads the pack when we come back. Back at Mobile International Speedway, getting ready for the restart, and leader Dominique Van Wieringen has chosen the outside. That's where she started the race and got the jump on pole sitter Spencer Davis.
Yeah, you can't blame her. It worked for her on the start, so you're going to try that until it fails, right?
Exactly. Trey Hutchins to her inside. Green is back out in Mobile. Way down to the bottom, that was Justin Haley.
Wow, he looked like he pulled out of line a little early there.
And we've got a lot of cleanup has been done for the 43 car of David Calabrese. Lost a motor, and they've got it cleaned up, but that's what all that dust was. Meanwhile, Tyler Dippel, he moves into second place, chasing down Dominique.
But guess what? Dominique was able to make that high line work again. She got that big drive off of turn two, got the run down into turn three, and held the lead.
More speedy drive fog here in Mobile. They've had clouds all weekend. They got another one now down in turns one and two. Here comes Haley in the five, now working on his teammate Harrison Burton.
He looks like he's got a pretty strong car there. He's certainly working the bottom awful well.
They battle for fourth in the banking of turns one and two. Burton with the advantage coming down the backstretch and rising to the high side there. We've seen a number of drivers, Frank, use that little bit of extra pavement that flattens out on the backstretch for speed.
Yeah, I think we're going to call that the Dominique line because that seems like what she's done, been able to launch her to the lead on both restarts.
This track has been utilized in the past by other NASCAR divisions. It currently holds ARCA races and a lot of late model races. So a number of these drivers have seen this track before and know where to find the fast groove.
Anytime you can extend the racetrack further and further off the corner, it allows you to put the throttle down a little bit harder and be able to drive off the corner and release the wheel a little bit. If you don't have that extra asphalt there and you got a hold wheel in it, you can't put the throttle down quite as hard as you want to. So you add a foot to these racetracks, these race car drivers, they're going to use it.
And I was also noticing down to the inside as we see Ruben Garcia Jr. taking the sixth down low, they'll use that low line in these corners as well, all the way down to the sand.
Absolutely. And if you take and put a little bit of concrete down there, they'll run over the top of that.
Kaz Grala, John Holloman, and Noah Gregson now battling for that 14th position. Gregson not that impressive in qualifying in the 55. He'll be competing in about 8 E-Series races before he tries to win the championship out in the West.
Yeah, I think he'll be strong here before the day's over, Dave. You know, he ran really well at New Smyrna, and he's got a lot of seat time between the K&N East and West. It'll pay big dividends for him.
Holloman, the youngster on the outside, trying to get around the, quote, veteran, Kaz Grala of the K&N Pro Series East, and he's got an advantage coming off the corner this time.
It looks like some guys that are able to get their car turning better are able to run that high line and make some passes. Guys that maybe are a little bit too tight, they're just not able to rotate the center good enough to make it work for them.
Good move by Holloman, his family team picking up some new equipment this year and putting it to good use. Meanwhile, the two leaders have pulled away. Dominique Van Wieringen in the black and yellow 30, Tyler Dippel in the blue and black 38.
You got to give your hand. Dominique has just really done a great job at New Smyrna. She didn't get the results she wanted down there. Then to come back down here, she was pretty fast in the test and come down here and qualify well and to lead this race like this is impressive.
Now the 20-year-old Ontario native, she is a super late model veteran. And she's run tracks like this before. I've seen her race at Bearfield Raceway in Indiana. It's kind of shaped similarly and has a lot of experience on these short ovals.
Yeah, I like the way she looks in the corners. I mean, she's really hitting her marks very well. She's not making any mistakes, just, conserving her tires right now and being smart with the race car.
NASCAR officials displaying the black flag. Now, we saw on the restart the five of Justin Haley go really low, and they're kind of throwing it in his direction, Frank. NASCAR generally likes him to stay in line up to the start-finish line on the restart.
Yeah, I couldn't tell whether he had jumped out before the start-finish line. I mean, I saw that he had tried to make it three wide going into turn one. Obviously, NASCAR saw, looking back at a tape version of it, they probably saw that he did go out before the start-finish line. And if you do that, the rule is you must stay in line until you get to the start-finish line.
Man, a championship in the balance for Haley. This could be destructive to that. Here's Derek with more.
Guys, we just heard from NASCAR, it's going to be a pass-through penalty for the number five of Justin Haley. He did not maintain his line on the restart. He's coming down pit road now.
And pit road, he enters in the backstretch. He's going to get kind of ahead of the leaders here by going through this very short pit road and then re-entering in turn number one. So they kind of set it up this way so that a driver doesn't automatically lose a lap if they get penalized this way.
Yeah, Justin Haley's going to be really happy with the result right here because he's not going to end up a lap down, even though he's going to get an infraction.
There he is over on the right, and boy, he's jumping way out of line there. He saw a hole, and he was going to go for it, but that's not in the rules.
Yeah, and it doesn't look like anybody checked up in front of him. It looks like he just got in the gas and decided that he wasn't going to lift a little bit. He was just going to go and see if he could get away with it.
So here's a challenge for the lead from Tyler Dipple. He gets down underneath the 30 of Dominique Van Wieringen, and coming off the corner, she's going to have to give up the lead as Dipple takes it.
And I think it'd be smart right here for Dominique just to settle down, not abuse her tire. We're only 32 laps in, and remember, we got to go 75 laps on this set of tires before they get another set of tires. But this is a good gauge for her right now. She's going to be able to tell her crew chief, you know, what the car is doing and why she had to give up the lead right here at lap 32. And in the second half, she hopes not to give up the lead.
And we mentioned at the beginning of the show, first time K&N cars are racing in Alabama, but this state has a large NASCAR history. Think of who's raced here in the past. You think of the Alabama gang. Bobby Allison, the 83 Sprint Cup champion, led the way. And their son, Davey, that big victory at the Daytona 500.
What a special group of people. And there's Neil Bonnett. When you mention the Alabama gang, he's one of the leaders of the Alabama gang.
And even Steve Grissom raced in the Xfinity Series and the Truck Series, and one of the guys that I got to know from the Alabama gang when I first got started here. Anybody missing there, Frank?
Well, you know what? We can't get everybody on there, but you know, you can't mention the Alabama gang without saying Red Farmer and Donnie Allison. They complete, you know, the Bobby Allison, the Neil Bonnett, and the Davey Allison of the Alabama gang.
Well, it's great for the K&N Pro Series East to be here for the very first time at the Mobile International Speedway and for the first time in Alabama. And so far, putting on a good show on a beautiful afternoon for racing. Trey Hutchins going the wrong way, though, in that 14 car.
Yeah, he qualified really, really well. I mean, you know, he's a single. That's the only car he's got. So him and his father really run hard to try to come to as many events as they can. And you know, he ran well in practice. Didn't get a lot of practice. Only 45 minutes here because of the rain on Saturday. And he was not at the test, you know, prior to the week prior. So that's probably hurting him a little bit here today.
And restarted at one point on the outside of the front row, and now is all the way back to eighth position. We also show the one car of Austin Terrio there, working his way forward, but Tyler Dipple grabbed the lead and has hung on to it ever since.
This young man's been impressive. I mean, for this only to be his second K&N East Pro Series start, he ran really well at New Smyrna, and his background is dirt racing, Dave. I mean, you know, he started in 2014, I think was his first time ever in an asphalt car. So to come out and do what he's done, and I know that he's with H. Scott and all that stuff, but, you know, he's beating his teammates too. And so, you know, that just shows you that he's done a great job.
Bigger problems now for Trey Hutchins. It looks like the right front of that car is kind of sagging. Looks like he may have a tire down, and he definitely has something wrong with the right front of that car. And he's off track now. He's going to bring out the caution.
Now, he's the guy that's happy there is no wall on the outside of the racetrack.
Just saved his race car right there. And caution out again here at Mobile. Trey Hutchins, again, the North Carolina driver, Bobby Hutchins' dad, been around the sport for a long time and trying to get Trey some valuable experience here in the K&N East Series. But that looks to be a little bit of a right front issue.
Yeah, you called it right there, Dave. I think that he knew it was soft going down the back straightaway, and he was trying to get it slowed down, just couldn't get it slowed down enough, and then when it did finally let go, you know, he slid over the banking right there. But it is nice that they don't have the walls in this situation, but I can promise you if somebody ends up going over one of these things at speed, they're going to wish that they either had a wall or it was a little more gradual than what it is.
Well, I mean, I know where I grew up watching racing at Berlin Raceway. Somebody go off the turn three area there, and, I mean, you'd hold your breath. Because they fly.
Yeah, we had a racetrack up, but, you know, Derek mentioned earlier that Oxford and Beech Ridge, those were kind of level, and they had a lot of sand. We had a racetrack I grew up on in New England named Catamount Stadium over in Burlington, Vermont area, and I've seen Chuck Bound, who was a Xfinity champion, go off of turn three airborne and roll seven times because of the embankment being so steep.
They'll try to keep it on the pavement this afternoon as Dipple and Davis come back to green here at Mobile. Row two, we now see Kyle Benjamin on the outside in that 40 car, making his car a factor.
And notice Tyler Dipple took the bottom right there, even though he, you know, his crew chief had seen Dominique take the lead from the outside on a couple of different occasions. His car is really working well on the bottom, and he's just gonna keep doing what's been working for him.
Boy, did you see Davis that last lap down the backstretch? He used all of that extra pavement out there as he tried to get by, but now has to fall back into second. Burton slides back into third. And Benjamin will hold on to fourth right now. Here comes Colin Capri in the two car. Great practice session and qualifying session for him, but just now starting to show the strength of the two.
It honestly looks like the top of the racetrack is not as good right now because everybody's been running the bottom, and they rubbered the bottom up so good that there's extra grip down there, and it's just the cars don't like that outside groove quite as much.
So Cabri into the top five. Here's Benjamin looking underneath of Burton in turn three and four. Nice move by Kyle Benjamin. He'll take the spot.
And this is the teammate to Spencer Davis. So now they're running 2-3 on the racetrack. We talked about them earlier. They've got a lot of depth in this organization.
Rainier Racing with MDM putting these guys on track this year, and they're showing their strength early on in the season and early on in this 150-lap event. Remember, we've got a halfway break, a competition caution at or about lap 75. They'll put on some fresh tires, work on their cars, and take them to the finish.
And we're at lap 79, so any time right now. And a lot of these guys, you know, are wanting to make some adjustments. And you look at Kyle Benjamin running as hard as he is right now. He's trying to abuse the tires so that he can really make a great adjustment at the halfway break.
Terrio falling back just a little bit now in the one car. Ronnie Bassett Jr. in the 04, trying to move his car through. Hunter Bayes in the 13 as well.
And all these guys right here have moved up four or five spots from where they started early in the race. So they've been methodical about this, not trying to overdrive the race cars, but making sure that they get themselves into the top 10. If they can do that, they'll have a chance in the second half to go for the win.
We've seen drivers who conserved a little bit at the beginning. We've seen drivers who charged out at the beginning. It's kind of been a back and forth, and we talked about that tire wear making itself pretty apparent here.
And that's what makes great racing and great racetracks is if you've got a tire that the degradation in it is good because of the racetrack, the asphalt being aggressive, that helps with making a great race.
And there's that competition caution. I did say at or about. A few laps after 75. And this will give the teams a chance to, as we said, put on four fresh tires if they desire to, which I know they will, and make adjustments on their race cars. But boy, Tyler Dipple in the 38, does anybody have anything to adjust to get toward him?
Well, I'll tell you this. If he doesn't like his car right now and he's got adjustments that he's going to make it better, everybody else is in big trouble.
He's going to tell Fuzz Bergdorf, leave it like it is. I like it just this way. And there's Justin Haley. He's now getting the free pass. He was the first car one lap down. We saw the penalty earlier for jumping the restart and getting out of line coming to the restart. And now he'll get a lap back. He actually got passed under green, Frank. He kept his lap at the beginning, but then the leaders got by him.
Yeah, that's right. I watched that, Dave. You know, as the race was going on, I was wondering when he's going to lose a lap or not, but he did not lose a lap. And as you just said, under the green there, about four or five laps later, we didn't show it on the screen here, but I watched him get passed.
So Haley will restart near the back of the field. We'll see if he can make his way forward after a fresh set of tires and adjustments to his five car. We'll be back with the second half. We're glad you could join us for this afternoon's race at the Mobile International Speedway. The sun finally shining, delaying activities for about 24 hours. And unfortunately for David Calabrese, it was an early end to his day. Dominic Van Wieringen led the first laps of the race, but Tyler Dipple came through and dominated most of the middle portion of this event in that 38 car. Trouble for Trey Hutchins, who had a good qualifying performance, but cut a right front down and his car off track and off pace and brought out the caution. Every team has had the opportunity to put four fresh tires on, make adjustments to their race cars, and try to track down and catch the 38 of Tyler Dipple. Now, Spencer Davis to his outside, Frank. Remember, he was a pole sitter. Lots of speed in that 41 car. We'll see who has the advantage starting the second 75 or so.
Yeah, I think this first restart right here is going to be very critical right here because you don't want to end up third or fourth here. You know, Spencer Davis getting beat on the inside.
Dipple chooses that inside line again, and he gets the advantage right away. Davis not able to fight back on the outside. The 40 car of Kyle Benjamin trying to take second away, and Davis is way to the outside there on the backstretch.
And he's going to lose that second spot to his teammate.
Colin Cabri in the two car, moving through on the inside, trying to challenge as well. He'll now take to Davis for third.
Yeah, that outside groove has gotten worse as the day's gone on here. Again, the more rubber they've built up on the bottom, the more grip they've got on the bottom.
Battle for fifth behind is between the 1 of Austin Terrio and the 12 of Harrison Burton.
Harrison Burton's getting shuffled back a little bit, too. Everybody would like to get to the bottom right now. And then you try to pass somebody by getting up underneath them off the corner and make them be in the high groove.
And Burton knows how to get around here. Had a victory here last year in a late model race. First time for the K&N Pro, of course.
Yeah, and he's gotten to the bottom right here now, and he's going to try to get by Spencer Davis and follow Austin Terrio through that hole.
Davis doesn't seem to mind the top too much there. He's actually, remember, Derek talked to him earlier. He's run a number of different divisions here at the Mobile International Speedway. Maybe he's comfortable up there, but he's not gaining positions right now.
Well, he's certainly comfortable up there. I think everybody's comfortable running that outside, but they're not wanting to be up there. That's the difference here. You're not wanting to be up there right now because there's not a lot of speed up there.
You know, he's talking about comfort, though. I like the way these cars look today. Everybody looks like they're in the track and really running well.
They are. There's a lot of grip out there. I think that those guys, everybody coming and getting a week earlier prepared, having, you know, a solid day of testing here has helped all these young drivers, especially early in the season.
So they just completed the five-minute break to change tires and work on their cars. The second half, so to speak, of the race underway now. Spencer Davis, Harrison Burton battling for fifth position. The lead is still all Tyler Dippel in the 38. Guys looking as to whether they should try to run him down now or save their stuff till the end.
And there's Colin Cabrie. He's made a strong move on the bottom. He's gotten by Kyle Benjamin, moved Kyle Benjamin to the outside. And again, we're seeing Kyle Benjamin. He's just going back, back, back. He's losing spots. First to Austin Terrio and now to Harrison Burton.
Cabrie, part of Max Siegel's Rev Racing program. One of four drivers in the field today, represented by that group. And running strongest of them right now. Second place for Colin Cabrie. Good battle between Ronnie Bassett Jr. and Spencer Davis. We know how it ended at New Smyrna. Hope it doesn't look the same way at the end here today. And you saw Bassett got a little tape on the right front of his hood there in the caution.
Yeah, he must have had a little damage there coming up through the field. He started quite a ways back, I think 14th in the field. So had to work his way up through here. Might have got a little bit of pushing and shoving earlier in the race, but doesn't look like it's going to be a problem speed-wise for him.
Hunter Bayes now challenging down on the inside of Dominique Van Wieringen in the 30 car. Led the first 29 laps, did Dominique, of this race. That's the most laps led by a female in the series. She broke that record by a mile. Four was the previous record. And now Bayes just a little loose under Dominique.
Yeah, that's a little break, good break for her. She's able to get to the bottom right there. I mean, again, I think that she just was in the outside line there. Kind of get freight trained once you get out there. Now she gets back. She can cool her tires a little bit and try to start making her move back towards the front.
Now, as we work lap 96 of 150, we're hearing from NASCAR that they are black flagging the 40 car of Kyle Benjamin. Fallen window net. Frank, these things shouldn't happen.
Wow, that's a tough break. You know, what we try to do is we actually run a small strand of tape around the latch. And the latch is snapped into some balls, but sometimes if it's over-tightened and there's too much stress on the net from how they mount it in the car, maybe it didn't get latched all the way. Maybe somebody didn't put the tape on. Either way, big disappointment. You just cannot have something like that take you out of a chance to win a race.
Running as well as he is, he'll have to come down pit road and get that taken care of. Will Kyle Benjamin. We'll be back to Mobile in a moment.
Hi, my name is Colin Cabrie. I'm 22 years old. I'm from Tampa, Florida, and I drive for Rev Racing. First season, it started out slow, a little slower than I think I expected. And towards the end, we had a good run, and we capped it off with a win at Dover last year. So that was definitely a good momentum starter for this year.
Colin Cabrie comes across the line, his first career win.
It's just very good to start out with, you know, a win under our belt already and know that we can come here and be competitive. I still look up to him this day. I'm a huge Casey Kane fan, just because of his background. I do like Tony Stewart. They came from sprint cars as well. Hopefully get a couple more wins and compete for, if not top five, compete for a championship.
Well, I'll tell you what, Dave, if you can win at Dover, Delaware, you can win just about anywhere in this country. That is a tough racetrack to win at.
Now, while we were away, there was a caution for debris. The field has been reset. Tyler Dippel is still the leader, and Cabrie will restart to his outside as we're back under green.
Harrison Burton's on the bottom. Can he move into the second position? We saw the last restart that the bottom was the preferred line.
Not much time left now, Frank.
No, there's not. And he didn't get a good run off of turn two right there. And we got a battle for the lead here.
Dippel is going to squeak through there as Cabrie now is going to look for that low line. I think he said, I'm going to lose positions if I stay up here.
Yeah, well, Tyler Dippel's been getting off the bottom of the corner extremely well all day long. I'm not sure that Tyler Dippel didn't say, I've seen enough of this guy side by side with me.
Dippel has been the class of the field all day, but can anybody catch him? Dominique Van Wieringen still running in the sixth position now, battling with Hunter Bayes up front. The one of Austin Terrio trying to mount a charge. But Dipple is now getting a few car lengths between himself and second place.
But you're right, Dave. I mean, this is where everybody's going as high as they can. The tire saving is over. They knew in the first half how long they could run hard and when they could start to run hard, and now they're doing that in the second part of this race.
Van Wieringen, Grala, Jesse Little now looking good in the 29 car. They're all battling for seventh.
You know, we haven't talked about Jesse Little a lot, but he's started 14th here today, and he's battled his way into the top 10.
And how much did he learn in that first half about tire conservation, what I can do with my car in the second half?
Well, we'll find out here in the next 20 laps here. You know, all these guys, how much harder they're going to run than they have been running. And it's going to be very interesting.
Just a couple of things to clean up. Remember, the 40 car of Kyle Benjamin was black flagged earlier because the window net had come down. They had to come down pit road and put that back up. And he restarted 17th on the field. We'll see how much ground he can make up before this is over. And also, remember the 5 of Justin Haley. He got back on the lead lap at the halfway break. He's now trying to work his way back up through the field.
Well, it's gonna be tough for these guys to really work their way up that far back in the field because everybody right now wants the bottom of the racetrack. We see right there, Dominique is getting up in that high line and she's not able to hold the bottom and everybody is passing her.
There's the 5 of Haley. We're watching the battle between Bassett and Allie Kern in that white number 4. Bassett with the advantage now over the Rev Racing driver, and he leads her down the backstretch.
Now, Justin Haley's moved up to 12th. He's trying to get to 11th. I mean, if he could get back into the top 10 with what he had happened to him today, it would be a great result for him.
Driving that car sideways through turns 3 and 4 and trying to catch that little lip of the corner, Frank, and help that car turn.
Absolutely. I mean, anytime you can get that left front to hook on a little bit of an apron right there, even a flat apron sometimes help it hook the bottom and just cut off, and you can get into the gas a lot hotter off the corner.
Whoa!
He's really hooked right there.
I was going to say, in the 55 of Gregson, I think got a little bit of a tap there from Ruben Garcia, and Garcia's now going to lose that spot to the 40 of Kyle Benjamin. Here he comes. Cody Rohrbaugh on the 7 now, trying to take advantage of Garcia.
Boy, they're using all the racetrack on the outside off of turn 2. I look like I saw a little bit of grass flying right there.
So there's pavement, then there's more pavement, then there's grass.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't get on the grass. Continuing to watch Dominique Van Wieringen and the 5 of Justin Haley. There's a battle for 13th now, and Benjamin's going to get through and take it from Gregson.
And that's 4 spots he's already picked up since he's back on the track.
That's a fast race car Benjamin had. Boy, what a disappointment for him to have to come down pit road and fix that window net. But that's a major safety concern if there's an accident. It keeps the driver's head from popping out the left side there. And so very, very important that they took care of that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll tell you what happens sometimes is when it first falls down, you'll see a driver grab it and he'll actually hold it up with one hand and drive with one hand. But NASCAR can see that. And that's what happened here today. They saw him holding it up there. They realized it had come down. And you just can't have that. It's not safe.
Into the back of Haley trying to get 12th. And he's going to let Justin know I am here and I'm coming through.
Yeah, Kyle's being aggressive here. I mean, his team and him got it on their shoulders right here. They've made a mistake, and he knows that he's the only one that can fix it right now.
Man, riding the 5 of Haley through the corners. And Justin just trying to stay ahead. It's like, you can have the outside.
Yeah, Justin will give him the outside, but he's not going to give him the bottom, is he?
And here goes Benjamin. Power move to the outside as we work back toward the front. 2 of Colin Cabrey still trying to track down the leader, Tyler Dipple. Austin Terrio runs in 3rd. Spencer Davis in 4th in the 41.
And I don't think any of these guys right now want to go up there and pass Colin Cabrey. He's running in 2nd. They realize that if we get a late restart here, they would rather be 3rd than they would be in 2nd. So I think that's why you're seeing, you know, not a lot of pressure by Austin Terrio being put on to Colin Cabrey right now.
Very interesting. And saving their stuff at the same time, right?
Absolutely.
So there's the gap up to the leader. Look at Dipple. What a fast race car that is today.
Now, the only chance you're going to have of beating him is really saving your stuff and hoping you get a caution. There's no sense in trying to run him down right now. Again, because if you run him down, that means you've passed Colin Cabrey, and now you're going to have to restart on the outside. And we have said time and time again, that has not been the preferred line in the second half of this race.
You see the Dirt Car Rookie of the Year status there. Love the way his Twitter page reads. It says, dirt or asphalt, hashtag gonna make it go. And Tyler has made that 38 car go very well this afternoon.
Yeah, you know, some of the tracks that he's grown up running at are half miles, but they're high bank dirt half miles. Lebanon Valley Speedway is an incredibly fast.
Whoa, off the backstretch. Who was that?
Looked like a plane.
Caution is out. We lost somebody off the backstretch there off of turn 3. We know there's no walls here, but there's a steep embankment there, and I saw the smoke, but I didn't see who it was.
Dave, I think it was Colin Cabry.
There goes the tow truck.
Because it was right there in that lead pack. It was either him or Austin Terrio.
No lap traffic was in there.
No.
See if we can see. Down the back, there's Cabry on the left, and he gets up. He's on the high side already, and the car goes straight. Oh, man.
Oh, he blew it right front. Looks like the same thing that happened to Trey Hutchins.
Wow. All four tires off and over the banking. Red flag is out while they check on Colin. Man, those are the moments you hold your breath, Frank.
Well, absolutely. Again, we're happy that there's no wall there because it didn't have to take a hard impact right there. That would have been a hard impact that way. We just hope that he's okay.
The field is under red. Safety team is going to check on Colin, and we'll take a break and bring you the finish of the Mobile 150. Welcome back to Mobile, getting ready for the restart. Colin Cabry is okay. A little bit banged up, but he's all right.
And Dave, the crew's happy because he didn't hit the wall, and when it came by on the hook, it didn't look like there was any major damage.
The cars remaining are going to fight it out to the end here. Tyler Dippel and Austin Terrio back to green here at Mobile. Getting down to the wire for a 150-lap race this afternoon. And again, Dippel with the advantage. Now Terrio getting a challenge from Davis down the backstretch. Terrio's going to pull through.
But Spencer Davis is wanting to get back to his bumper and try to move him out of the way with five to go.
Terrio's had a strong car all afternoon, that number one, but Dippel has pulled away. As we look back to a further battle, look at the lead now. He's got three or four car lengths over second place.
With five to go, I don't think anybody can count on another caution right here. So they're going to try to go as hard as they can, try to get to second, and maybe hopefully something happens to Tyler Dippel. You never know late in the race.
Oh, here's Davis with a move off of the corner. He gets underneath Terrio down the backstretch, side by side. Second place up for grabs. Davis is going to take it.
Yeah, no strategy here. It's just try to go as high as you can and get as many spots as you can late in the race.
We saw Jesse Little. He's now up to fifth, and the caution is out. What could derail Tyler Dippel? Maybe another caution and another restart, but he's had him pretty much nailed down all afternoon.
He sure has. I don't think he's really concerned about a restart here. I think he's had the best car in the field today, and he's got four more laps, and he'll try to get to victory lane.
There's the reason for the caution right there. Dominic Van Wieringen, who had a fantastic qualifying effort, now relegated to the back of the field after this.
You know, she's had fantastic speed, Dave, all year long. In these first two races, I should say. Qualified third, I think, at New Smyrna. Second here this weekend. Led laps early. So she's got the overall speed. She's just going to have to fine-tune a little bit of her management of tires.
So Tyler Dippel, the 15-year-old from Wallkill, New York, leads this field, and he'll have to endure a green-white checkered. How's his crew chief feeling?
Dave Fuzz Bergdorf is the crew chief for your leader, Tyler Dippel. The car looks like it's been on rails all day. What's the driver been telling you?
He says the car ain't bad. He's doing an absolute phenomenal job to have no more experience than he does. He's doing great. The car's good.
This kid being a dirt specialist, how impressed are you with him on pavement?
Very. Sometime we unloaded at New Smyrna last week, 2 weeks ago. He's been fast. I thought we were going to have trouble wearing out tires, but he seems to conserve, save his tires as good as anybody. He really does a great job.
Tyler Dippel looking for his very first NASCAR K&N Pro Series East win.
You know, that is the interesting thing that he brings up right there. Coming from the dirt background where they're always sliding the cars sideways, you know, on a dirt tire, that's okay because it's so much cooler with the dirt. You can't slide these tires sideways all day long. And the fact that he's been able to figure that out this quickly is very impressive.
What a story for Tyler Dippel, the family business. It's on the quarter panel of the car there. Supported his racing up to this point. He got a ride with H. Scott Motorsports with Justin Marks, and now he has a chance to win in his second ever try in the K&N East Series. 15 years old, Frank, 15.
15. Unbelievable, Dave. Really is.
Now, this series will make up to three attempts at getting a green flag finish, so they'll go green, white, checkered here if it's a clean restart. Dippel, Davis, Terrio, Burton for the win in Mobile.
Another great jump by Tyler Dippel.
He comes through clean through turns one and two, and that 38 is back out front. Jesse Little looking down to the inside of the 29. He'll get by Austin Terrio for third.
Everybody's trying to get to the bottom. Look at Harrison Burton. He was fourth. He's falling back because he cannot get to the bottom right here.
White flag coming out for Tyler Dipple. Can Little do anything with Davis on the final lap? Great battles all the way through the pack trying to get what they can, but Tyler Dipple is far out front. No one's going to catch him. The 15-year-old from Wallkill, New York, will come off of turn four, and Tyler Dipple will win in Mobile. What a race for everyone. What a dominant performance by a kid. My gosh, what a racer Tyler Dipple is.
Tremendous job all day long. And I want to mention, too, sixth place. Kyle Benjamin came back from 17th in these last few laps to finish sixth.
A lot of good drivers in the field today. There is the best of them, Tyler Dipple. We'll talk to him when we come back to the Mobile International Speedway from Victory Lane. There is Victory Lane, and it's occupied by the 15-year-old Tyler Dipple. He has won the Mobile 150 on a day that saw a great crowd enjoy a spectacular event and a fantastic green-white checkered finish. Let's go to Derek.
Big block dirt modified star Tyler Dipple puts it all together on pavement this afternoon. He wins in the NASCAR K&N Pro Series East. Come on over here. We want to talk to you really quick. Tyler, a race that you dominated. Did you know that the car was going to be that good right away?
I knew it once the green flag dropped. Oh, my gosh. I can't even believe it, really. Just, oh, I can't thank the guys enough. I never could have believed this could have happened. It just, oh, my gosh.
Did you know how good your restarts were? Every single restart, you kept taking off from the rest of the field.
Oh, yeah, that's what the guys were telling me. I just can't thank the H. Scott boys enough, my crew chief. All the guys just gave me such an awesome car. I just really can't even believe it. The second race here, and we're talking to you in Victory Lane.
Tyler Dipple, another one of those young drivers that takes H. Scott Motorsports with Justin Marks to Victory Lane in the NASCAR K&N Pro Series East.
Dave, this is not as easy as he made it look. I got to tell you, at 15 years of age.
He's got a lot of talent. Here are the results. We see Dipple Davis and Jesse Little in the 29 comes back to third. Terrio and Growler round out the top five, and there's Kyle Benjamin, like you talked about, Frank, back up to sixth.
And there's the H. Scott teammates, seventh, eighth, and ninth.
Here's the rest of the top 20. Dominique Van Wieringen disappointed on her afternoon after a great start. The field of 25 rounded out by these drivers who were a little unfortunate today. Dylan Bassett had a power steering issue. David Calabrese lost a motor. Clayton Green finished 23rd today. Here's Derek with second place.
Well, Spencer Davis started on the pole, came home just one spot short, but were the restarts hurting you?
Yeah, we were definitely at a little bit of disadvantage on the restarts, having to start on the outside. You know, I thought I finally got that golden ticket to start third, but, you know, it's cut short. But, you know, everyone that were near racing with MDM gave me an awesome car. And, you know, they definitely knew we were here. We played the conservation mode, you know, kind of like you would at Greenville. Kind of fell back, but then it showed at the end we have plenty of tire. Just, you know, we needed one small break this time to get that W. And, you know, it still feels good to come out of here with a points lead.
After the restarts, when you were getting back in the throttle, were you getting wheel spin?
Yeah, initially when we were go real hard on restarts, I could feel minor wheel spin. You know, I was trying to regulate that the best I could. But the main thing was is that I spin those tires, so I might have to let one or two go, but then it show, you know, we turn on all the fans, you know, I do some adjusting inside the car, and we go right back by them. So that was real fortunate, you know, that our car could hold that long-term speed every restart.
Well, Spencer Davis may have come home in second, but he leaves Mobile International Speedway with the number one spot in the points.
Yeah, the patience that he shows on the racetrack and listening to him right there, Dave, is going to pay big dividends in trying to win this championship.
Potential for the championship, great for Spencer Davis. Dipple now with that victory, just 1 point behind. And Kyle Benjamin with that strong comeback, still very much a contender in this championship today. Third place with Derek.
Well, Jesse Little plans to run a partial schedule this year between the K&N Pro Series and the Truck Series, and it seems like you're having a lot of fun doing this, aren't you?
Oh, that was a blast, man. I was just telling that guy that I don't know if I'm out of shape or if that was just such a hard race, but it was a battle. We started 14th, which was a little further in the back than we had hoped, but I was able to use the first 75 as a kind of like a test segment and see how bad the tires fell off, and I was able to judge that for the second to save and drive on up there. But it was a great day, and I can't do it without, you know, the tremendous support back at Red Jones Racing and NASCAR Technical Institute and PFC Brakes. So those guys are allowing us to get to the track this weekend and every weekend, and without them, I wouldn't have this top five. So great day, and I'm extremely excited for 2016.
Not a bad run for Jesse Little today. Podium finish.
I'd say that was an outstanding run. He gained 11 spots. He was the biggest mover in the field today. But what a quiet third-place finish. We really didn't talk about him until the end.
Saved it for when it counted. The next race you can join us on for the K&N Pro Series will be the West Race from Irwindale Speedway. That'll be on Friday, March 25th, 10 o'clock Eastern, the broadcast time. Well, 150 laps went by quick here this afternoon in Mobile. The best of them, Tyler Dipple, as the K&N Pro Series made their first trip to the Mobile International Speedway. First time for the series in Alabama, and they did not disappoint. Dipple was able to capitalize early and often and avoided the trouble that others saw, including Colin Cabrie, who took that flyer off of turn three. Thankfully, he is okay. We're sure glad you could join us here from Mobile. For Frank Stoddard and Derek Pernasiculio, I'm Dave Burns saying thanks so much for joining us. We hope you enjoyed today's broadcast, and congratulations to the winner right there, Tyler Dipple from Walk Hill, New York. He is the victor today.